All right. Hi, everyone. Is everybody back from the break? As Barry mentioned, my name is Tatiana, and I work for a blockchain software house at Works. And also, I volunteer in a Works for Justice organization who hosts today's events. So I kind of represent our community. There are some amount of us here. I've seen familiar faces. But those of you who don't know about Works for Justice, I welcome you to come by our stand and learn about our initiatives. Okay, and today, I forgot something from my bag. Sorry. It's a talisman, I need to have it. Thank you very much. Anyway, the talk today will be about the importance of clean code. And my talisman, I would like to introduce you. This is the guy, that little mole, that you might think he's blind, but that's not a big problem, because after this talk, I hope that whenever you find yourself writing something that is considered bad code, this little guy will just pop right into your mind and remind you to be a good boy or girl. Okay, so let's start then. My talk is inspired by the book Clean Code, written by Robert Martin, who's known as Uncle Bob. And I would like to ask you if there's anybody in the room who haven't read the book. Could you please raise hands? Cool. Nice. It's not a bad sign. So my talk is dedicated to you. I hope you learned something today, and those of you who have read the book, I hope this talk will be a great reminder of those concepts that you use on a daily basis. So first of all, I'm going to talk what is a clean code, how do we define the clean code, and why is it so important, and then I'm going to go step by step on some steps how to achieve this clean code. And what is the definition of the clean code? There are as many opinions as there are developers, but I personally like the definition of clean code is like a good book. It's easy to understand and a pleasure to read. This raises a first question. Read the code. Who's going to read the code? And to answer this question, tell me, please, if this situation does ring a bell with you. So you're sitting there, like, coding, right, developing, JS, blah, 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 blah. And then all of a sudden, you run into some kind of old code, and you're like, that looks such a weird solution. Who would have wrote it? Like, this seems so wrong, right? And then you're like, okay, just for fun, I'm going to run the git blame, right? I'm not going to blame anybody. I'm just going to see it just for myself. And you're like, dig, dig, dig. What? But like, oh my God, I wrote it? I mean, like, what? How could I possibly do this, right? You probably know the feeling. So this situation actually a good sign. It means that you see your mistakes from the past and you're improving yourself, right? Today we're going to learn how to not become the guy just like this, who blames himself. And so the answer to the question is a first person who needs for you to write the good code is yourself, for the future yourself. The second reason is that we usually work on the projects as a team, not by ourselves, right? And this means that at some point, somebody is going to work on the code that we wrote earlier, or at some point, we're going to go through a code review. And so somebody else is going to read our code as well, to sum up. And if your code review looks like on the left-hand side picture, you're doing good, actually. And if the code review of your code looks like on the right picture, oh boy, you're in trouble. Even if you write a good code, you clean it regularly and... the natural way of code is natural of development of the code is that it tends to rot in time in any way, like no matter how hard you try to keep it clean, it's not like a problem. It's a natural thing. To deal with this problem, I would like to offer a solution that also comes from the book. Is that there's a Boy Scout rule in the American Boy Scout organization that stands that to leave the campground campground cleaner than you found it. And when we apply this rule to our code, it means that whenever you run into some kind of piece of code that just looks bad to you, it worth an effort to invest some time in refactoring it and cleaning it while you're working at this code, rather than to postpone this to the later situation, which we all know never comes, right? Mm-hmm. So I've been talking about the bad code for a while now, and in order to understand what is a bad code, I would like to present a metaphor of this, let's say, ugly house, right? So imagine you have a house, and it has like broken handles or windows that are so incorrectly positioned somewhere on the top. Then in order to get a fresh air in this house, you have to go all the way to the garage, bring the ladder, climb the ladder, and then open the window, and only then you get a fresh air. That's something that you don't want to do. That stinks, right? So this is how you, if this is how you feel when you see some kind of code, it means that there's some improvement could be done on the code. Some steps for doing this, we're going to proceed to them. And first, the most important thing in the code is naming. It's something that we do on a daily basis, no matter what we write, either classes, functions, methods, even a simple variable, all of them have names. And the first rule for that is to use the intention-revealing name. With this particular example that I've provided, we have this variable d, which holds the date. And at this point, it seems quite okay. Like, okay, d date, it's quite understandable, right? But then imagine that you pass this variable somewhere else and further in code, you lose the track of what this variable holds. So you have to go all the way back up into the assignment in order to remind yourself what this variable holds. In order to avoid such situations, you should consider naming the variables in a way that it provides information what the variable holds. Another example, avoid disinformation, kind of connected to the previous point, DC. In this example, like DC, you start to wonder, what could it mean, like a document or a data collector or, I don't know, like anything, right? And unless you go all the way back to the assignment, there's no way to understand what it means. But if you call it days counter, it gives you some additional information, right? You know, okay, so this variable holds a number and it has like a number of days for some kind of concept. I don't know. It depends on the context. Another rule is to make meaningful distinctions. It is considered a bad approach to use numbers in naming our entities. For example, here we have two dates. Some of them is in the past, some of them is probably now. And then the name of it, the date one, date two, gives no information to us. And when you name it the first date, which is first date of some kind of event, and the current date, which is today, the name by itself gives you the information what we hold in this variable. Pronounceable names. If we have a close look for this this name, the first feeling we have is like, is a cat ran all over the keyboard or something? I don't know. But then you look closer and you see that there's some kind of pattern, right? There's like a day, month, minute, second. Wait, so it gives you an impression that it holds some kind of date or maybe even a timestamp. But the name for this variable makes no sense to us. So naming it a timestamp, and for example, creation timestamp, would be a better solution in such situations. When it comes to naming classes, classes themselves represent objects. And in natural language, like English, for example, we use nouns in order to name objects. So naming classes with nouns is a good way. Another thing that classes have is methods. And methods represent the actions of those objects. And for actions, we use verbs, which is why the naming classes with verbs is also the solution to go with. And we should also remember that accessors, mutators, and predicators are required to be named using the part of the name would be get, set, or is, accordingly. Another rule says that for consistency reason, you have to pick one word per concept, what it means. For example, you have some kind of services that perform different operations, but then they kind of are semantically similar. And if you name each of them differently, like a controller, driver, manager, and so on, you might get loose what actually the whole structure of your project will be lost. It will be messy, right? So you should consider picking one word for them and stick to it. Use the, for example, in this example, controller for each kind of those services. Different names for semantically different methods. In this example, if we just speak as a people about it, like with a natural language, we say that on the first one, we add two variables, and the second one adds some kind of value into the array. While it is the same in a natural language, and it feels like for consistency reason we should use the word add in all such methods, but if you look under the hood of those methods, they semantically do different things, because first one adds two parameters and creates a new value, and the second one mutates the existing value and extends it, right? So it puts some kind of new variable into this array. Semantically, they do different things. So we should consider using different names for such methods. Use solution domain names. So for most of the time, your code will be read by your fellow programmers, which is why you should not be afraid of using some math or science terms in naming your entities. For example, here, if you name something CoinMarket, right? It gives no information other than probably it is a class, because it sounds like a noun, it's an entity, it's some kind of class. What does it hold? We have no idea. But when you add API at the end, just a simple three letters, you immediately see the information that you probably can call this class to get some information. For example, like a currency exchange rate or something. But at the same time, opposite to the previous rule, using problem domain names is also a good approach in a situation where no mathematical approach or like programmese approach could be found easily. Instead of extending the name and actually using the explanation in the name of the variable, using a business name would be a better solution. Okay, and the next thing we do in programming, we write functions. There are some rules for functions, and the first rule says that functions should be small. The second rule for the functions, they should be even smaller. And how do we define small functions? We check that they are under 20 lines alone and have no more than two levels of indentation. And the second, the third rule for functions is that they should only do one thing, or so-called single responsibility principle. And how to achieve those things? You do decomposition. You extract some things into smaller variables. Functions. You move some stuff around, and you end up with a clear code. Functions should follow the common query separation rule, which stands that functions should either perform a comment or answer a query. It should not do both those things at a time. So in the first example here, you can see that if set wrapped in an if gives you a feeling that set is returning some kind of condition, some kind of information. But the name of it stands that it should only set some kind of value. What you should instead do is that have a method that returns the information that you need for this condition, but then the set method should only do the setting of the value, nothing more. Also, your function should not have side effects. For example, here in this code, if you can see, the login of the user goes like this, that you verify whether the user is authorized to enter some kind of service, and then you set the login, and then for some kind of reason, you redirect it to profile. This is actually a bad thing. This is a side effect, and a good solution for such situations would be perform login by itself separately, and then have some kind of other method that checks whether the user is logged in, and then perform the action of redirecting. It'll be a separation of responsibility. Another important concept of functions are arguments. And there are some rules for arguments as well. First of all, you should keep as little, as few arguments as possible. And the reason for that is that, for example, if you write testing for those functions, the more arguments you have, the more test cases you have to provide. And it's something that is going to give you some trouble, right? So the less, the better. And if you really, really do have to have a lot of arguments for the function, you should consider wrapping it into an object. And avoiding flag arguments is another rule, which means that if you pass an argument to the function that has a Boolean value, it means that your function does two things, performs either on a true action or the false, the action that is connected to the false flag. It is a sign that your function could be separated into two separate functions. Errors. Errors also come in our functions, and there are some rules to handle them. And first of all, do not be afraid to throw exception. It is a common thing that whenever we run into an error, we just console log it, so somebody could see it, right? This is wrong, and it is good to throw an exception from the function and handle it from the side of the caller of this function. This way, your application would not break. Another rules for errors is that they also should handle one thing, and actually those two concepts go kind of together. If you extract try catch into block, you follow single responsibility principle, and you have the handling function just by itself, and you call it whenever you have an error, and this is a solution. And the most important rule for functions is do not repeat yourself. Okay, next concept to cover is classes. Classes have similar rules as functions, which means they should be small. But if we talk about functions, they should be small like a length-wise, but then if we talk about classes, they should be small responsibility-wise, do one thing. And again, follow the single responsibility principle. Comments. Comments is something we as a programmers use a lot in our code, and there are some rules for that as well. So, for example, the main rule is that comments do not make up for the bad code. What it means is that whenever you have a code that seems kind of confusing and you feel like you need to explain why this is happening, it might be because you should better extract it to some kind of function or variable or whatever it is, depending on a situation, and use the descriptive name instead of writing the description of in a comment. Another rules for comments, there are like good comments and bad comments. So the good comments could be like legal comments, something that you are forced to use, like for example, you use public library that forces you to mention the link to the library in the code, or explanation of its intent. Opposing to the previous rule, there are some situations when you're forced to use some kind of unobvious solution, and you want your future fellow programmers to know why you use this solution. You feel like you need to explain, and there's no way to, you know, do it better. You need to write an explanation, so you leave it in the comment. That happens, it has to be as well. It's a good thing to do. Warning comments, some kind of comments that you want your fellow programmers to know that do not run this code, do not remove this code, or do not move this code around because it's going to break some kind of logic. Those warnings are also considered good comments. To-do comments. Some programmers argue that to-do comments are not a good thing, but for me personally, I think that while the project is still in the development process, to-do comments help you to keep track of something that might get lost in the future. So I would call them a good comments. Now, the bad comments. Bad comments are redundant comments, like when they explain something that is already obvious. There are some developers who do that. Another comments are misplaced comments. For example, you write a comment for some kind of code, and then you move the code around, but you forget to move the comment. And what happens is that it doesn't match the code that it stands next to. It has no meaning, and it just messes the code in general. So you need to keep an eye on that and remember to move everything all together, the piece of code. And GSDoc in public code, what it means that GSDoc by itself is of course not a bad comment, not a bad thing to have. But then at the same time, if your code is not going to be like a public library or like publicly available thing, there's no need for GSDoc comments. Okay. And the next concept is TDD. So the magical world of test-driven development. There are some companies that for some reason do not write tests. They always say like, we don't have time, we need to deliver features, the customer is waiting, a client is waiting, and stuff like that. But I'm gonna try to pursue you that you do have time for tests. Because, for example, you are writing some kind of feature, and you spend some time to think about this feature. You write some kind of graphics on a paper, you do some mathematics things in your head, and like calculations and stuff, and you like think the path is the logic of this feature. But instead, if you would have it written already in front of you, it would help you. It sounds like something that would help you, right? So test is exactly the place where you do it. You first, define the problem and define what you expect of the function to do, expect the result of this function or feature or whatever. You already have the problem defined in the tests. And the second reason is that it provides prevents you from the future mistakes when you have this written down, because some of the things that you come up in your head or on the paper, it might get lost. You can forget about it, but then if you write it in the code, you have it written once and forever. So one of the concepts of TDD is that tests come first. What it means is that whenever you start writing a feature, before writing it, you write a test. And the way to do it, there's one concept that I like. It's called red-green refactor. The way it goes is that you write tests that do not obviously success because there's no implementation for this thing that you were implementing. So you write the red so-called red test first. Then you make them green, which means you implement the feature to make the tests pass. And then you look at your implementation and see if there's any way to refactor it to make it even better. And then you start all over again. You come back to the red, green, and refactor. And another rule, it actually kind of is a concept of unit testing, but you should have one asset per test, which means that, in other words, if you have more than one assert, and let's say your tests are failing, then it'd be harder for you to debug where is the problem. And so one asset per assert per test will be easier to maintain. There are also some rules for TDD, like rules. Yes. First of all, your test should be fast, because if your test runs slow, you will feel like, oh, I don't want to run the test because they're slow, it's going to just waste my time. And then it would lead to some kind of leaks, you're going to miss some kind of problem because of that. So fast tests pressure you to run them as much as possible. Second of all, tests should be independent. What it means is that tests should not set up an environment for the other tests. They should be. We should be able to run the tests by themselves without any other, tests, fellow tests, right? Repeatable. Repeatable tests are those that we can run in any kind of environment, whether it's production, whether it's development, anything. They could be. They have to be the same. Provide the same kind of checking. Self-validating. Self-validating tests, it means that they should only return either true or false value. Either they fail or they succeed. No other additional information is needed. And timely tests are the rule of timing is that the test should be written before production. It prevents you from introducing the bug into production. Okay. And recently I've been asked a question. So, okay, clean code is good and stuff, everything. There's like a refactoring and blah, blah, blah. There's a good solution. But then you run into some opinion that there's another good solution for your problem. And basically you get into discussion and you realize that, well, both of the solutions are equally good. And how do we decide which one is better? So if you're working in a team, there's a good thing. It is a good thing to establish some team rules in order to avoid problems. For example, you come up with some kind of consistency. You say that if we run in a problem like this in the future, we use this solution and we don't argue about it anymore. It's going to save us time. It's going to save us problems. And if you're having a problem or a hard time of deciding on consistency, you should be open to compromise with your colleagues, and sometimes pressure your solution, and sometimes agree that someone's opinion might be a little bit better, and just go with it, and do it like that. And another thing that was going to help you to keep your code better, cleaner, is a code review. For some reason, there are companies that don't do, the teams, not companies maybe, that don't do code review. But this is a bad thing. I stand that every project should have a code review because, first of all, it prevents us from losing the problem, like we can catch some kind of problem before merging it into a master branch. And second of all, sometimes, for example, some kind of junior developer would say, yeah, but how can I do code review for a senior? He knows so much better, he's more experienced, his code is so difficult, and blah, 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 blah. Still, the junior developer should do code review because even looking at the code that somebody wrote and is better, it's going to help him to learn new things. So, in conclusion to everything that I've said, if you ever feel that you have some kind of bad code that looks like this broken house, I hope that today's rules will help you to learn new stuff. And if you follow them, you end up having the beautiful masterpiece that is this beautiful house. Thank you very much for listening.
Wow, that was even shorter than the time. That's pretty amazing. Tatiana, I love you.
Thank you.
I do. No, I really do love you. Does anyone have a question for Tatiana? We have time for one, even two questions. I wish I could see you, but I know you're out there. Someone have a really important question that seems like seemed like very useful information. I don't know the difference between clean code and... what's the opposite? Brudny code?
Messy.
Messy code does not sound good. So do we have a couple of questions for Tatiana? Anybody? Don't be shy. You know.
I hope it's a good sign. So you're.
Oh, okay. We have one. Here you go, okay. Sir.
Hi, Tati. Congratulations for your great presentation. So there was a point maybe you could evaluate more because at first glance, I would disagree about. So about JS docs in private repository. So I do use JS doc in private repositories, say in the company work code, right? Because it's just the way to make comment more useful for me because it has a great support from my IDE when I just hover a mouse over the function. I can see clearly that there are some parameters which needs to be described a bit more. So for example, that the time I need to pass is in milliseconds, for example. And some similar stuff. So this is a good way for me to keep the code understandable. So what do you think about it?
Well, I think if it helps you, then probably it's not a big deal if you use it. I mean, it's a good thing if you use it. But remember that it could be overused, right? So if it gives you some information about methods or like parameters that are confusing and you need this information about the type, yes, sure. You should use it, but also if you feel like that's something that is help, that's something that you need like this, maybe you should consider using TypeScript, because without using JSDocs, it gives you all the information you need to know.
Fantastic, good answer. I knew that she would have the answers to everything. This is really fantastic. I could tell from the beginning you're a very organized person. One more question. Do we have any question, anyone? Okay. Then, Tatiana, we thank you very, very, very much. Very much.